Let's start off with the diuretics, and let's start with the most simple of diuretic mechanisms, the osmotic diuretics. The most commonly used osmotic diuretic is mannitol. It literally pulls water into the collecting tubules. It also works very, very well in intracranial hypertension. Now, as a high blood pressure pill, it doesn't work that well in particular, and in clinical use, we don't use it much at all. We use it a lot in people who have had some kind of a head injury and we're trying to reduce the intracranial pressures. It is an important medication and it will be on your exams. Just remember, clinically, we don't use it that much. The next class of drugs are the carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. The prototypical drug in this drug class is acetazolamide. We don't use it that much in hypertension, but we do use it in other areas. Now, what it does is it inhibits carbonic anhydrase, leaving more sodium, bicarbonate, and chloride in the collecting tubules. Now, this results in a metabolic acidosis, so it is used in altitude sickness. It can cause low potassium or hypokalemia, and it can cause low sodium or hyponatremia. And finally, it can also cause low chloride levels or hypochloridemia. In terms of using it for altitude sickness, how it works is by causing a metabolic acidosis, you are automatically protected from the hypocapnia and respiratory alkalosis that you would develop at high altitude. So it tends to help quite a bit, and I personally have used it when I was climbing mountains in Peru. So certainly it's a very good drug for altitude sickness, not so much for hypertension, so we don't use it that much in high blood pressure. The loop diuretics are very powerful diuretics. The prototypical drug is furosemide, sold as Lasix all over the world. One of the newer loop diuretics is ethacrynic acid or etacrin. Ethacrynic acid is often used when people have an allergy to furosemide. Finally, there is another loop diuretic called bumetanide. It's not particularly used, but if you have allergies to the other two medications, we can resort to it. How it works is by reducing sodium reabsorption in the thick ascending loop of Henle. That's a good exam question, by the way, so I want you to remember that loop diuretics work in the thick ascending loop of Henle. And so it's going to be very powerful because it alters the countercurrent mechanism that you see in your loop in the kidney. Now, if you just review your physiology lectures by Lecturio on the kidney, you'll see how powerful the countercurrent mechanism is in the kidney. And when you disrupt that countercurrent mechanism and you disrupt the way that it works with the loop diuretic, you get quite a massive diuretic effect. So it is the most powerful of the diuretic class. Of course, there's downsides, and that includes low potassium. And in some cases, you may also get low sodium, although that's a lot less common. Furosemide is a very effective drug in renal failure as well, so you'll often see nephrologists prescribe it in certain circumstances. The next class that I want to discuss are the thiazide diuretics. Now, these diuretics are a little bit weaker than the loop diuretics, but they're used more often. And in fact, we sometimes combine the diuretic right inside the pill with ACE inhibitors and ARBs. The most commonly used in North America is hydrochlorothiazide. The most commonly used in the UK and Europe is indampamide. Both are used in both places. Indampamide is purported to be better tolerated, and that's what a lot of people believe. I personally haven't found that to be the case, but remember that there are people who are going to have allergies to hydrochlorothiazide, and that's why we use indampamide. For your perspective, you need to know both, so just remember that they're both thiazide diuretics. There is a third diuretic that I want to mention, which is called metolazone, and we're going to mention it later in the lecture when we talk about heart failure. The next class of diuretics are quite interesting because they are potassium-sparing diuretics. Now, up until this point, every single one of the diuretics that we talked about cause low potassium. This is unique because of the way it works. It does not cause low potassium. And when you have people who are prone to having low potassium on diuretics, you get quite concerned. Now, what happens with amiloride is that it inhibits sodium reabsorption in the collecting tubule. Now, sodium and water, free water, are still excreted, but the potassium stays in the body. There are three channels that we want to talk about where amiloride could have an effect. There's the ENaC, or the epithelial sodium channel. There's the NHE1, which is the sodium hydrogen antiporter. That works in the heart, in heart failure, and it also works in the kidney. The ASIC, or acid-sensing ion channel in inhibition, is also another potential action that amiloride works through. There's a low risk of hypokalemia for obvious reasons, and it does cause a metabolic acidosis. The other potassium-sparing diuretics are spironolactone, which is sold as aldactone, and it's a very powerful aldosterone blocker. It inhibits sodium reabsorption, and it actually is the only diuretic to have been shown to reduce mortality in heart failure. So it's a very, very good drug, and it's one of our main drugs that we use in high blood pressure control. Now, one of the downsides of a drug like spironolactone is that it does potentially raise your potassium level. And one of the most commonly used antihypertensive medications are either ACE inhibitors or ARBs, which also raise the potassium level. So although it's a great drug, we don't use it that much because the patient's already on a drug that raises potassium, and we don't want to raise potassium too much. The interesting thing, too, is that it has an anti-androgen effect. So in women who have hirsutism, or, you know, where they grow a mustache and have male characteristics, you can actually give them low doses of aldosterone, and that helps with those masculine kind of characteristics. The testosterone is very active in the skin in those patients, so you can either use an anti-testosterone treatment, which has lots of problems, or you can use something simple like aldactone. Triamterene is another potassium-sparing diuretic. It inhibits sodium reabsorption as well. It acts in the collecting tubule, and it also works through the ENaC channel. It's got a low risk for potassium or hypokalemia. It can cause hyperkalemia in some patients. Once again, this drug causes also a metabolic acidosis. One of the things that you have to be particularly aware of with triamterene is it can cause renal stones or nephrolithiasis. And those stones are going to be calcium oxalate stones. So that's another good exam question. What kind of renal stones can you get from triamterene? And the answer is calcium oxalate.